So welcome to the 8th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We are being joined remotely today by Audrey Nicol, Pauline McNeil, Fulton McGregor, and Jamie Green is running late. The first item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the Draft Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Financial Limit Amendment Regulations 2022. And I welcome to the meeting Ash Denham, the Minister for Community Safety, Denise Swanson, Interim Deputy Director, Civil Law and Legal System, and Martin Brown, of the Legal Directorate from the Scottish Government. I refer members to paper one, and I initially invite the Minister to speak to the Draft Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Financial Limit Amendment Regulations 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. And thank you for the opportunity to speak about the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Financial Limit Scotland Amendment Regulations, which will support the coming into force of a negative instrument, the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022. So legal aid legislation sets out prescribed limits of initial authorised expenditure. This is the amount of money that's available from the legal aid fund to cover the costs of fees and outlays before a solicitor must seek approval from the Scottish Legal Aid Board to incur any additional costs. Now, due to increases in legal aid fees, including those to be delivered by way of the negative instrument in front of you today, it's likely that without amendment to the current authorised expenditure limits that apply, would frequently be exceeded by solicitors when they're providing advice and assistance to clients quite early in their instruction. And the effect of this would be that solicitors would be required to seek the prior approval of the Scottish Legal Aid Board to ensure the full payment available for the work that is being undertaken, and to require such approval for payment that would otherwise be permitted in the table of fees would result in additional time, resource and bureaucracy, both for legal aid providers and also for the Scottish Legal Aid Board. So these regulations increase the initial limits in authorised expenditure in order to address this, and provision is also made to increase the maximum total fees per court session allowable to duty solicitors representing accused persons in the sheriff or district courts, meaning that so-called session limits that apply to duty sessions will allow for the same number of accused persons to be represented under a session, notwithstanding that the fee per case has increased. As stated, the regulations support the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Regulations 2022, which will primarily deliver the second part of the Scottish Government commitment to uplift legal aid fees by way of an increase of 5% in 2021 and a further 5% in 2022. And these regulations also provide for a new supplementary payment for a solicitor to claim when attending a holiday custody court sitting. And finally, these regulations address an anomaly that resulted from a decision in a case reported in early 2021 on the interpretation of Schedule 4 of the Civil Legal Aid Scotland Fees Regulations 1989, and in particular how these should be applied to the fees of senior counsel. So that gives, I hope, the committee a brief overview of the regulations and their context, but obviously we'd be happy to answer any further questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Minister. I'll now invite questions from members, but I'll quickly kick off with one of my own, if that's okay. We have received correspondence from the Law Society of Scotland, which you will have seen, and what they say in response to this is that the regulations before us do nothing to address what they describe as a legal aid system at breaking point. What would your response be to that?
Well, I think the regulations in front of you, obviously the 5% uplift that's included in one of them, that was a commitment that was made by the government during COVID. So over the last 5 years, just to run through what the government has done. So we did a 3% uplift in 2019. We did the 5% uplift in 2021 that I've referenced already. You got the 5% uplift for 2022 in front of you today. We've also put £1 million into funding for trainees. So that was 40 trainees, because that was in response to the issues that the profession had raised with us about capacity. So that was an attempt to go some way towards helping to find a solution to that. And we also invested £9 million into COVID resilience grants. So I feel that in general, the Scottish Government obviously considers the profession to be a partner with us in access to justice, in running the court system, and obviously because of the pandemic, you know, going forward, you know, addressing the backlog that we have, particularly in the criminal courts, and we see them as a partner. And this is an attempt by the Government to demonstrate how much we value the profession by continuing to uplift the fees. We're also in the process of working on packages of fee reforms. One of them we referenced in a letter to the committee, which we're developing at the moment. That has gone, the full package of fee reforms has gone to representatives of the profession. I think it was last week.
On Monday this week.
So they're able to have a look at them and decide what they think of those. And, you know, that represents a significant investment as well. And all of these have been developed in concert with the profession, where we've been listening to the representative of the profession, you know, adapting things, changing them in order to create packages of reforms that hopefully do go some way to addressing the situation that we have at the moment.
Thank you. I think Katie Clark now has a question.
Thank you. Approximately £500 million was cut from the legal aid budgets up until 2019. And since 2019, there's been increases. The increase that's been proposed in the statutory instrument of 5% is obviously below current inflation rates. Do you accept it's an effective cut?
I don't know.
But if inflation is in the region of 7%, and it's 5%, surely you must accept that the value of the money that lawyers will be receiving is going down. It doesn't, you know, keep pace with inflation.
So over the last few years, you know, we've had a 3% rise, the 5% rise, the 5% rise now, you know, the additional money for COVID resilience funding as well. So I do accept that there are professionals, practitioners working in the system who feel that rates should be raised. I totally accept that. You know, that is obviously for them to put that case forward. And we spend much of our time working with the representatives of the profession. So that's the Legal Aid Board. We work with the Law Society of Scotland and the Bar Associations. And I have said right from the beginning, you know, we've obviously put this fee rise, the one that you're considering today, is across the board fee rise. But there are other ways of doing this as well. And I think that some of the proposals that we've got in the fee package that the profession are currently considering show that I'm completely open to discussing these things with the profession. And if we can find ways of addressing, you know, individual fee reforms that can get more money into the pockets of the practitioners, then I am completely willing to consider that. And I've said that all along.
But the rates that lawyers are receiving are broadly similar as they were receiving in 2007. As I say, there have been increases since 2019. Do you think that explains why so many lawyers are now saying that they'll no longer do legal aid work?
Well, I think there are lots of lawyers that are still doing legal aid work. So this is obviously an attempt to listen to what the profession are saying and put a significant amount of government funding into legal aid. So we do take it very seriously. Denise, is there anything you wanted to add to that point?
I think some of the reduction in expenditure in legal aid that you've referenced was in response to the economic downturn and savings packages were made. Now, these were around mainly kind of subsidiary fees, things like photocopying fees and so on. And many of the fee arrangements that were put in place were done so in response to discussions and negotiations and agreement with the Law Society at the time. So, you know, for example, they agreed to take a kind of cut in one fee so that we reduced the number of PDSO that would be operating in the legal aid system. So there are a range of reasons why fees that we have in place at the moment have been agreed. And they were agreed at the time, and I can provide the committee with a readout of the various fees and the negotiations and how we got to those fees. So that's how we've got to where we've got to at the moment. So I can have that information sent to the Justice Committee.
That would be useful. Could you explain what PDSO is?
Oh, sorry, it's the Public Defence Solicitor's Office. So they are employed solicitors by the Scottish Legal Aid Board, and they participate in the duty schemes, and the percentage of duty scheme time that is allocated to PDSO was agreed with the Law Society and the profession at the time when PDSO was put in place. So that's quite a historic agreement. But there are other things, you know, one fee was reinstated and another fee was cut. So there were lots of agreements and discussions made with the Law Society at the time of those fees being put in place. But as I say, I'll have that set out for the committee and sent over.
I mean, what you're saying conflicts strongly with the representations mm-hmm. that lawyers and their representatives have made to us. Mm-hmm. So if you could provide us with that information, we will put it to those organisations. Yes. But what they're saying very clearly is that there's been massive cuts, and we've mm-hmm. only got to look at the rates, the hourly rates, mm-hmm. etc., to see that is indeed the case. But we'd be very grateful for any information you're able to provide. Yeah.
Thank you. Got a question from Pauline McNeill, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. The Convener said at the beginning the concerns were from the profession about the increases, though they're very welcome, don't really meet the whole needs of the service. The Minister will be aware that between 2010 and 2020, the number of firms providing civil legal aid decreased by 16%, and I met with some of those firms. And they do express concern that they are losing lawyers from the profession. And the case of criminal firms, it fell by 25%. And in fact, that's what the committee have been hearing for some time. That I'd put this question to virtually everyone, the Lord Advocate, anyone in the criminal justice system, because unless we keep lawyers who give those accused of crimes some choice in who represents them, then we really need to make sure that we're not, we do all we can to make sure that we have a healthy legal profession. I just wondered if the Minister had concerns about those figures, about the number of lawyers we're losing from firms doing legal aid. Thank you.
Yeah, I thank the Member for that question. So, I mean, one of the instruments that you've got in front of you today, it's obviously got the 5% uplift in it, but it's also got a new payment in it. So this is a supplementary fee payment for holiday custody courts. Now, this mm-hmm. is a direct attempt by the government to listen to solicitors who were telling us that they wanted this to be addressed. You know, there are solicitors who are working in these holiday custody courts who were not getting an additional payment before, who, if the committee agrees to this instrument going through, will be getting additional money. So we are constantly listening to the profession. And, you know, as I've said, we will, you know, adjust fees where we think that is going to have an impact. So if we talk about, because you mentioned civil, so the reforms, I know this is quite confusing, we're talking lots of different things. So the reforms package that we've developed, that we've put in front of the profession on Monday, which the committee will have seen some correspondence regarding, you know, there's solemn proposals in there, there's summary proposals in there. So in the solemn proposals, you know, that also represents significant additional funding. It is a response to requests that the profession have made to us to bring in or to change some of the fee rates and so on. So we've done that. I'll ask Denise in a minute to come in and explain a little bit more about that. But it's also to say that in discussion, it was agreed that the civil side would be left at this point to a later date. So it's just to give that information to the committee. So it's not to say that we think everything's fine in that front. We have a commitment to come back to that and look at that for fee reforms for the civil side as well. So I would like the committee to perhaps think of this more as like a starting point, that we're starting here, you know, we're continuing to consult with the profession about, you know, changes. We're putting money into this, you know, this reform package that we've put on the table this week. represents several million pounds, again, of additional funding. So, Denise, would you like to add a little bit more on that?
Yes, I think what we're looking at now are shorter-term improvements that can be made, while the longer-term issues around the substantial and significant fee uplifts that the profession has requested can be dealt with. And this was an approach that we discussed with the profession in December and in January. So both the proposals that are with the profession just now reflect those discussions that we had in January. So there is a longer term issue around the significant uplifts that have been requested by the Law Society, and those have to be dealt with as part of our spending review process, because they do represent a package of around £57 million per annum, and so we need to work through ways in which that budget might be allocated to the legal aid fund. I think as well, in terms of solicitors leaving the profession, this was something, Minister, that you discussed with the President of the Law Society yesterday. We're not clear from the figures presented how much legal aid was done by those that have left the profession. We have a kind of trajectory of those who provide legal aid. We have a small number of firms that do an awful lot of legal aid, and a lot of firms that do a little bit. And we're not sure if it's those that do a little bit that are leaving, or those that are doing a good proportion of legal aid. And that was something that the Minister discussed with the President of Law Society yesterday, to see if we could start to get under some of these figures and unpick them in a little bit more detail.
We have a question from Audrey Nicholl, who's also joining us remotely.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. You've possibly just answered the question that I was going to ask in your response to Pauline McNeill's question. You obviously have shared some helpful correspondence with the committee in which you outline some of the sort of shorter term and longer term areas that you're looking at and measures that will be considered in terms of legal assistance. And obviously we have the Legal Aid Reform Bill coming down the track as well. But I suppose my question was just to ask, given that those potentially will be opportunities, and from the previous response, it sounds as though there are opportunities to reconsider legal fees in that work. I'm just interested to know why the 5% increase has been brought forward now, and whether or not that could have potentially been sort of rolled up into some of the work that will be coming forward down the line. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, so this was a commitment that was made by the government, was it in 2020 or early 2021?
Yeah.
That we would commit, you know, in discussion with the profession, I think it was around about Christmas time 2020, that the government agreed to increase legal aid fees across, you know, an across the board measure. So at that point, we committed to that, the 5% over the 2 years, so last year's one and then the one that's in front of you today. So that was a previous commitment that that we are making good on now.
Thank you. No other member of the committee. Oh, sorry, a bit hasty. Jamie Green would like to ask a question. Sorry.
Thank you, Convener. Apologies for missing the opening comments, Minister. The car park is still quite busy in the mornings. I've had a few extra questions to ask you. You'll obviously will have seen correspondence from the Law Society of the 23rd of February, where they indeed recognise the 5% uplift, but they say that it is significantly below the rate of inflation. Obviously, that's an issue for small businesses particularly. The last paragraph of their letter to us say that they say the legal aid system is at breaking point. Now, I don't know how much of that is crying wolf or how much of that is true. What was your assertion of that summary of the legal aid system?
Well, I mean, I don't know if you caught some of the earlier discussion. We've had quite an in-depth discussion about a number of these points already. And what I've said, you know, is that I meet with representatives of the profession on a regular basis. So I actually met with the chief executive of the Law Society yesterday. And so we carry out, you know, regular meetings with them. And I have to say to the committee, they are full and frank discussions. You know, there is no holds barred, and the profession, you know, to talk to the government and say, you know, what their perception of the issues are. I would say that as a government, we then have to assess the evidence, and then we can make decisions on policy based on that. We have heard, you know, the profession, and that's why we have given the uplifts that we have over the last few years. We know that the profession, among other, you know, businesses, industries, etc., were very impacted by, you know, the pandemic. So we sought to obviously give them additional resilience funding for that. So I would just say that, you know, I do accept that the profession feel very strongly about this, you know, that they are quite right to obviously strongly represent their profession and to try to get the best deal that they can. And that is completely legitimate, obviously. My job is to look at this and to see among the, you know, the sort of procedures that the government uses, if you like, and we've talked about the spending review as being one way of, you know, deciding on priorities for the government and how spending gets allocated across the board. My job in that is to try to find a way through this and to make fee reforms where we think that they're going to be of benefit. So we've got the obviously the instruments in front of you today, which I think do represent a significant investment. We had a bit of a discussion perhaps before you arrived about an additional funding package, which hopefully you've been able to see some details, which again is additional funding on top of the you know, the instruments that are in front of you today. So I am listening to the profession. I'm doing my utmost to respond to the concerns that they're raising. And we are working with them, you know, certainly my officials are working with them on a weekly basis to respond to their concerns and to develop fee packages that respond to some of the concerns that the profession has raised, which is what I've been trying to work on over the last year. So, for instance, you know, the holiday custody courts, that was an issue that was raised with us. And it was something that I wanted to resolve so that, you know, practitioners that are working in those courts are getting an additional supplementary payment. And so that's one of the things that's in front of you today. So, you know, I've said it before. I'm happy to say it again. My door is open. I'm willing to talk with and work with the profession on fee reforms. And that is what we'll continue to do.
Thank you for that comprehensive answer. I guess the difference here is that unlike other businesses who are affected in COVID, the inability of solicitors to undertake their duties or even survive as going concerns affects members of the public in a very different way to other types of commercial businesses. They also state in their correspondence, which we received yesterday, we've just had time to digest, there's a paragraph with key questions in it. Now, they're obviously posed to us, which we are supposed to pose to you, but I would request maybe if you reviewed those key questions and responded to the committee so that we can forward that to the Law Society or indeed make it public. But they say that, I get the impression that they're not confident that there's sufficient capacity in the defence bar to address the backlog of cases. And I think this is quite a key point, actually, and it's irrespective of the argy-bargy over fees. Are there physically enough people in the system that even if you increase capacity in SETS, if the prosecution service was able to increase capacity, but yet that inability to increase defence capacity at the same rate means that you will not get through the backlog at the rate that I'm sure we all want to get through? Is that a concern to the government?
You know, obviously capacity issues have been raised with us, and we take that very seriously for the reasons that you've just suggested. We obviously did put £1 million into the traineeship fund, which you will no doubt have seen. So that was an attempt to at least go some way towards addressing the sort of capacity issues that had been raised with us. It's something that we obviously are monitoring extremely carefully. And that is something that I guess over the, you know, sort of more in the medium term timeframe could potentially be addressed in the legal aid bill, which is should be forthcoming during this session of Parliament.
That's helpful. One final, if we have time. Sorry, I know you...
Yep, we do. Yeah,
okay.
Yep.
This issue has cropped up a few times, and we did take evidence on it during the early part of the committee's establishment, and that was around salaries. when we posed this question to the Lord Advocate, the response was very much that people take a bit of a pay cut when they go into the public service from the private sector. But I get the impression that the Law Society think otherwise. They believe that there's maybe a sense of poaching good quality solicitors from the private sector into the government or civil service or public bodies who require legal governance and legal assistance. Do you have any indication as to where the truth lies, or is it somewhere in the middle there? What, you know, our average salaries much higher in government agencies than they are in the private sector, for all the reasons we've talked about and the issues that they've been facing financially?
Yeah, I think this is one of the issues where it's a bit like apples and oranges. It's not able to, we're not able perhaps to directly compare them, but I'll maybe ask Denise if she can give a bit of detail on that in a moment. But I would say that obviously the Crown salaries are published online. On the other side, you know, it's private companies who are obviously free to set the rates that they want to. So, Denise, could you give a little bit more context on that?
Yeah, I think the short answer to the question is we don't know. We have had discussions again with the Law Society and the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association about collecting the evidence and data that will demonstrate some of these situations. Obviously, in private firms, it's a decision of partners on you know, how much salary is paid to employees, and that's quite often commercially sensitive information that some firms may not want to share. So these are some of the things that we've been trying to unpick with the Law Society and the SSBA to say, you know, what kind of evidence could we develop to see where the disparity might be and why. It was also something that came up in the payment panel and a recommendation made in the payment panel report around building that evidence base and that database. And that work on the payment panel research is ongoing. It will be critical that we get the support of the profession in sharing information on salaries, terms and conditions, working, work time balance, work life balances, and so on, so that we can try and properly ascertain what the disparity might be.
I guess the answer is to improve retention, stop people leaving the profession.
Yeah, retention and recruitment was a problem
as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
I think we have a final question from Katie.
I do. I was just wanting to put one of the points on the level of income that's been put to us by the Law Society of Scotland to get your reaction. What they're saying is that even taking into account the recent uplifts and those introduced by these regulations, legal aid rates will be around 60% lower in real terms than when the Scottish Parliament was created. I mean, it's quite obvious when you look at the hourly rates that they haven't gone up by very much. But what the Law Society of Scotland are saying, that this is in the context of long-standing decline in overall legal aid expenditure, with the 2021-22 budget being £138 million in comparison with £160 million in 2010-11. Do you accept all that?
I think we need to consider the levels of legal aid provided. So expenditure is most of the expenditure does go on solicitors' fees, but it depends on how many applications for legal aid are submitted and how many are offered, are given. So we have seen a decline in that time period of legal aid applications, and those are charted in the Scottish Legal Aid Board annual report. We are starting to see an increase on that. We started to see an increase just before COVID, particularly around sexual offences cases. So we are starting to see a build-up. So I think it's not necessarily a straightforward correlation between legal aid expenditure and fees, because it depends on how many cases. And I think caseloads have reduced for the profession during that time period. But it's something I can take away again and try and provide the Justice Committee with a kind of more structured response to that point made by the Law Society.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Oh, sorry. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly. Morning. Minister, I think what you said, this has been a starting point, would be quite reassuring. Can you confirm that negotiations and discussions will continue with legal professionals on this issue?
Yeah, absolutely. So if we go back to the reform package, so that's the one that's not in front of you at the moment. This is additional reform. So the solemn proposals that we've put forward, we've already discussed them in quite a lot of detail with the profession. So they are pretty much ready to go. And I would be able to bring them forward to the Parliament, really quite soon. The summary ones, I think, need a bit more development. So we're going to take a little bit more time to develop them. But again, that's something that absolutely could be progressed this year. So those ones are already in development. And it certainly is a starting point. And, you know, I think there's a lot of reform needed to the fees. And it's an ongoing process, as I was saying before. But we're happy to consider any suggestions from the representatives of the profession on, you know, how fees could be changed, altered, or whatever going forward, and we would consider that.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Great. Thank you very much. So no other members of the committee have indicated they've got any more questions or comments. So we'll move straight to agenda item number 2, which is the formal business in relation to the instrument. It's consideration of the motion for approval of the affirmative instrument, and I invite the Minister to move that motion, S6M03003, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Draft Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Financial Limit Amendment Regulations 2022 be approved.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do members have any other final comments? Online. Okay, and I'd like to just give the Minister the opportunity to respond to that if you would like.
Thank you.
Okay, so if not, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Yep, good stuff. I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we have considered today. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Great. So that completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and her officials for attending. And we'll now move to a short suspension to give us time for the witnesses to depart. So thank you. Okay, so moving to agenda item number 3, which is subordinate legislation. It's the consideration of 2 Scottish statutory instruments that are subject to the negative procedure, and I refer the members to paper 2. Do members have any comments or questions on the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2022. No. Okay. And do members have any comments or questions on the Parole Board Scotland Amendment Regulations Rules, rather, 2022? No. Okay. So no members have indicated that they've got any comments on the 2 negative SSIs. That being the case, are members content formally not to make any comments to the Parliament on these instruments? Okay. We will now have a short break to allow witnesses to join us online for the next agenda item. To agenda item number 4, it's the coronavirus bill. It's to continue our scrutiny of the provisions in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill. I refer the members to papers 3 and 4, and I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting, albeit virtually, Vicky Bell, who's a member of the Criminal Law Committee of the Law Society of Scotland, and Stuart Murray, who is Vice President of the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association. We very much appreciate the time you've taken to join us this morning, and I intend to allow an hour, up to an hour and 15 minutes for questions and answers. And I'd like to remind members and witnesses to try and keep questions and answers pretty succinct to fit as much in as possible, and also to ask members to indicate which witnesses you're directing your questions to. If any of our witnesses would like to speak, you can let us know you want to come in by typing R in the chat room for request to speak. We'll move now directly to questions, and I'll perhaps open up with a fairly general question in respect of what is, I suppose, known as virtual trials or virtual proceedings. And it's really to ask both of you generally what you regard, after 2 years now of this COVID experiment, which has become a bit of a reality, general pros and cons from your perspective. And I don't know who would like to come in first, but I'll leave it up to you. Thank you. Maybe Vicky, would you like to go first?
Good morning, convener. Thank you for the opportunity to participate today. Yes, I will try to go first. So pros and cons of virtual proceedings. If I could start by saying the criminal justice system and the partners involved in managing virtual proceedings as a result of the pandemic have been impressive. Best efforts, always the intention. Always with these things, particularly involving technology, it hasn't always worked. There have been delays caused due to technical difficulties, particularly, as an example, for remote jury trials. The link has been known not to always work, or witnesses giving evidence from abroad, various technical difficulties encountered that have resulted in delays. Now, the system is used to dealing with delays, even with in-person witnesses, so we respond as and when difficulties occur. But just an observation that technical faults can create delay. Virtual trials. I have not personally participated in a virtual summary trial. My peer Stuart has more experience. The only observation I might offer is the need to be consistent across courts. There is a baseline for virtual trials and then a variation in practice, depending on which court. And I think it's vital that those who are accused, I beg your pardon, are appropriately supported and have access to justice, but the same for complainers and witnesses. They would receive pastoral care from volunteers at the court who are part of victim support, and that would need to be considered if this were to become a long-term practice. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And the same question to Mr. Murray, please.
Yes, well, again, thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence today. I think that I am wholly disappointed by the resulting systems that we're now working with in relation to virtual courts, virtual trials. I have read, and I won't name names, but I have read commentary by sheriffs, sheriff principals, and some politicians that has been a resounding success. But I can say, I think, on behalf of the vast majority of the profession, that it's been nothing but a resounding failure, unfortunately. I say that with the caveat that I think there perhaps were those amongst us, and I say us, I mean defence solicitors, defence agents, that were opposed to the introduction of virtual courts in whatever process or procedure that was from the beginning. And, you know, admittedly, some would never accept the introduction of a virtual court system. But others that I know well tried hard to accommodate the new systems. And, of course, those systems have changed during the pandemic. They've changed in their structure and in the software that was used. But ultimately, even those, I think, that were pro-virtual courts have now taken the view that the majority of the time they are just entirely inappropriate. I think the main reason for that is that really the one thing that all courts should focus on is access to justice. Ministers involved in the justice profession should be focused on access to justice. Solicitors that appear as defence agents and fiscals that appear on behalf of the Crown should all be focused on the phrase access to justice. And the virtual system simply does not allow for that in a realistic and practical manner. And I think it's interesting that it's referred to as a virtual court, because ultimately something that's virtually something is not the real thing. And it is significantly detrimental for the majority of our clients, I think, certainly in the criminal arena. Perhaps in the civil arena there is more room for it, and perhaps in both civil and criminal proceedings there is room to utilise virtual courts or elements of the virtual court when it might assist with witnesses that are travelling a long distance in order to give evidence. But essentially, in the criminal realm, an accused person should be entitled to have their accuser in the same room as them. And my view, and the view of the profession, I think, is that it takes away some of the solemnity of the court process.
Thank you, Stuart. Now, Vicky's connection appears to have been lost, so if we can focus our questions until she returns on you. You're in full flow, so that's perhaps a good thing. And I'd like to move on to Pauline McNeill, who is also joining us remotely.
Thank you very much, Convener. I wanted to ask Stuart Murray, I think what you said in your evidence that we should consider access to justice on the issue of the virtual system. So you said have accusers in the same room. I wondered if are there any elements of the process that you would think would be appropriate for virtual proceedings? Witnesses, for example, would you take the same view for witnesses giving evidence virtually? So any part of the process, because the government have indicated that it's a road that they wish to go down. So I would welcome your comments on that. Thank you.
Yes, yes, thank you. As I've said very briefly, I think that the virtual system could be used for bringing certain witnesses into the court room effectively, virtually. But there are so many different types of witnesses, of course, both in criminal trials and civil proofs, that it's not possible to discuss witnesses per se. I do think that, I mean, as I've stated already, I do think that the removal of witnesses generally, not always, of course, not in perhaps in the case of expert witnesses, one might say, but generally, I think that there is a move away from the solemnity of proceedings. And I say solemnity, when I talk about the solemnity of proceedings, I'm speaking about, of course, summary level and solemn level trials, principally summary, of course. But I think that being in a court, physically being in a court, and even if it's not in the same room as the accused, perhaps giving evidence by way of a video link from another part of the building, it adds a degree of importance and adds a degree or reinforces the solemnity of these proceedings. These are people's lives that we're dealing with, people's liberty on occasion that we're dealing with. And it's important that those witnesses that come to court actually do come to court to give evidence, because only then, I think, for most of them, not all, is it entrenched in them that this is a serious matter and not something to be taken lightly. Hope that answers your question.
Yeah, it does. Convener, I just wanted to ask about the extension of time limits. Would that be okay?
I think we'll come on to that after we've... Yeah, but thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I'm finished. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, we've got questions from Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. It's a supplementary to the earlier question. I just wanted to address Stuart Murray's point when he talks about the solemnity of the proceedings. We've heard from Women's Aid, Victim Support, that actually it's very intimidating for victims and witnesses, and solemnity, it might seem that way to the legal professionals, but not to the people in court. And I just wonder if you take that on board, that for certain victims, solemnity is not really what they're looking for. They're looking to be, for a fair and a court hearing where they can express what's happened to them without being intimidated.
Well, I think that's a very interesting take on the process of coming to court with respect. Firstly, what I would say is that, of course, victims appear in court. Of course, there are individuals who are accused and have committed sometimes minor offences and sometimes, frankly, quite horrific offences. But the starting point which you've given me is that of victims not wishing solemnity. And so it appears very much that you're discussing every complainer that comes to court as being a victim. And of course they are not, because often accused persons are found not guilty or not proven, acquitted in one way. We have to get away from this culture of discussing complainers as being victims. In your point, I suppose, to some extent well made, you spoke about the stress, I suppose. I don't want to paraphrase you, but the stress of coming to court. But I might take this chance to remind you that it is stressful for the accused person to come to court. And you must bear in mind the cornerstone of Scottish justice, which is that you are innocent until proven guilty. So to speak about victims prior to a trial being concluded is, in my opinion, wholly inappropriate and absolutely forgetting about the solemnity that is required both for the complainer and for the accused, as well as witnesses who have given up their spare time to give evidence in these matters. The serious nature of these things can only be dealt with through a level of solemnity which impacts on everybody in that courtroom.
Thank you. I'd just like to add that witnesses are always witnesses. So, yes, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'm told that Vicky Bell's connection has been repaired and she's back with us. I'll move on to Katie Clark, who has some questions. Thank you.
Thank you. We've written to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to ask for information about the extent to which virtual trials and other forms of criminal procedure have been taking place during the pandemic. As you know, this legislation is proposing that the default in all summary cases, which is many thousands of cases every year, should be virtual. Could you give us an indication of how many virtual cases you think have taken place? I appreciate you won't have numbers, but anecdotally, you know, what percentage of defence agents' casework would have been virtual during the pandemic, and whether you're aware of any evidence as to what happened during those cases, including outcomes, you know, whether people were found guilty, not guilty, or not proven, and also, you know, what kind of charges and sentences were involved in those cases, so that we can take an evidence-based approach in our decision-making. I appreciate you've not been researching these issues, but could you give us a feel for the level to which virtual trials have been taking place in summary cases, perhaps in different sheriffdoms or in relation to specific types of charges? I don't know if Vicky has anything to say there. I know that she said that she hadn't dealt with any cases herself, which in itself is of great interest.
Thank you, Minister. Apologies for demonstrating the cons of remote participation. It was not deliberate. I don't have any sense of the information that you are requesting. I can offer, if it would be helpful, to invite the Criminal Law Committee to consider the questions and respond in writing. I suspect they would be willing to do that, but would draw on data from other justice organisations to inform the response. So Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service will have an oversight of how many virtual proceedings have occurred, cross-criminal and civil proceedings. It has been used in civil proceedings also and has been welcomed in civil proceedings as something that could become a more permanent feature of civil proceedings. Crown Office, Procurator, Fiscal Service would also have oversight potentially. I can share from knowledge that all solemn proceedings have been remote in part. Jurors have been remote, but the courtroom itself accommodated the judge, prosecutor, defence, the person accused, and I think a combination of witnesses attending in person, witnesses participating remotely, and in solemn proceedings that would be in the Sheriff Court and the High Court. So a broad range of solemn offences. The maximum sentence for a solemn offence in the Sheriff Court is 5 years, and in the High Court there is no a maximum. As far as I understand from discussions in the Criminal Law Committee, the members of that committee are made up of a combination of academics and practitioners who work in both prosecution and defence. And the overall view, certainly in relation to solemn proceedings, is that there has been no obvious impact on the journey of a case in relation to the verdict or the resulting a sentence.
Could I ask Stuart to come in on those issues?
Yes. I mean, Vicky makes a very important distinction between summary procedure and solemn procedure. And I think it's fair to say that the High Court practice using the or facilitating duties from cinemas, that seems to have worked relatively well. Certainly as good a system as we could have hoped for in order to get the High Court and Sheriff and Jury Courts up and running again, because of course those deal with the more serious offences in the criminal justice system, and it was vital that they took priority, I suppose. But I think that if you spoke to most criminal defence lawyers, and I would also say most advocates, criminal defence advocates, whilst they accept that it works to a degree, it is again far from ideal. I think I've yet to see a jury trial where at least one juror doesn't start to nod off during proceedings. And that's because they're not in the court anymore. It's because they're not, it doesn't feel, I don't think, like a tangible experience for them. So there are difficulties with the remote system, even in the High Court and the Sheriff and Jury Court. I think that, speaking more broadly, the percentage of summary virtual trials has been very low. And that's partly to do with a change in the technology, I suppose, partly to do with, again, as I mentioned earlier, witnesses just not taking the matter particularly seriously. It's really hard to gauge, quite frankly, what the figures are, because for some considerable time, both in my time with the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association and previously as the president of the Aberdeen Bar Association, and I should say that I know that my colleague who took over from me as president of Aberdeen Bar is having the same difficulties, is getting the data from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to allow us to see what the figures are here. We just don't know, but that data has never been provided. And it's important that it is provided if this is to be realistically assessed. But the perception on the ground with my colleagues at the coalface is that this is not something that should be pushed through as a default, unless, of course, the accused person wishes to comply with the new procedure. And I appreciate also, as I realise that I'm going on a bit, appreciate also the focus through the Scottish Government has been to prioritise those matters as of a domestic nature. But actually, there are other procedures which could equally benefit from virtual courts, and perhaps benefit more from virtual courts, such as, you know, minor road traffic matters, etc. But perhaps because it's easier to deal with witness-wise, and perhaps because those cases very, very rarely lead to loss of liberty or loss of some right other than a driving licence, of course. Even matters as of a domestic nature can be very serious. And so generally people wish to be able to have that within the confines of the court estate, the court building.
It's been suggested by some defence agents that the balance between prosecution and defence has been impacted by virtual courts, with less people being acquitted. Is that something that you're aware of having been said, or something that you've seen it in any way?
I would say that personally, it would be misleading of me to say that I had witnessed that personally. I am aware of the anecdotal evidence from others that take that view. Of course, there's no possible way of knowing because, you know, when a case is prepared for prosecution, we're given evidence effectively on paper, other than, of course, by way of CCTV, etc. But for a long time, CCTV couldn't be utilised in a virtual trial. And so that was part of the reason that virtual trials, the content of them, had to be limited so much. So we've really not been able to properly assess how a virtual trial runs in a sheriff court without a jury. It's just impossible to fully comment, I think, without the data from SCTS. But the reality is, as I keep saying, that why should an accused person be forced to deal with something virtually when, by the very nature of it being virtual, it is indicative of something less than the real thing? And that is an experiment. Why should these people be, subjected to an experiment for what can only be an attempt to save money and to move matters on? What's interesting, of course, and it's not really fully connected to this, but what's interesting is that the Crown, it's an important point, the Crown have, as to date, have yet to draw a line under anything because they have prioritised everything. When it comes to actually fixing a date for trial, they can only prioritise a few cases. And so, despite the huge backlog continuing to build and build, the Crown take no view on minor Justice of the Peace Court matters even, which will not impact hugely on society, but will continue to increase on the backlog.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll move on to Colette Stevenson, followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to Stuart and Vicky. I wanted to touch upon the comment that you made, Stuart, at the beginning, and that was that in terms of virtual hearings, that it's actually been a resounding failure. And I wanted to maybe see if you could expand on that, particularly where there's been remote attendance in terms of appearance of accused from, like, police custody. I know that there's been concerns raised from the Law Society, and they've highlighted concerns and also argued that more detailed work is required here. I wonder if you could maybe touch upon that and see... What's went wrong there? I mean, you're obviously, it's a strong comment that you made in terms of, a resounding failure. And what could work better?
Well, yes. I mean, I think what you're talking about essentially here is virtual custody hearings where accused persons are appearing from a police station somewhere in the country. Not always, in fact, in the same city or town in which their court appearance is. Then, at the very outset of virtual custody hearings, I spent a significant amount of time with Police Scotland and the Chief Inspectors who were heavily involved in the setting up of that process. And what we found were a number of things. Firstly, the technology was woefully inadequate. The idea, I suppose, initially was that virtual custody hearings would take place in a police station, principally for those who were diagnosed with COVID, being COVID positive, or had suspicions of being COVID positive. And that was, on one level, an appropriate thing to do because it prevented a COVID-positive person being brought into court and, dealt with social distancing and social contact. But unfortunately, it very rarely worked. The technology very rarely worked. Each court is different, so I can only speak about Aberdeen here. But, we would try to speak to somebody in the cells, perhaps in Kitty Brewster Police Station, and we wouldn't be able to connect to them. When we could connect to them, we couldn't hear them properly because the camera was in a different room through a glass panel from our client. The police then also decided that they would carry out and SCTS, carry out a trial system whereby they would choose randomly people to go through the virtual custody system. But that led to huge concerns because, of course, very often, it is only when an accused person sits in a cell block at a court with their lawyer, an experienced lawyer who's been dealing with people with multiple issues for many years, only then did it come to light that an accused person might have mental health issues, might have drug problems that weren't entirely patently obvious at first sight, might have difficulties because they were younger people with lack of experience of being in a court. And ultimately, very many of our clients speaking to us from the police station cell block felt that, rightly or wrongly, their perception was that they were being dealt with by people who were hostile to their requirements. And so only when these individuals were brought to the court to allow them to speak to us face to face were we able to put their mind at rest to some extent, not wholly all the time, but it allowed them to see that the person that they were speaking to was interested only in their needs, looking after their concerns and often multiple issues that they faced in their sometimes chaotic lives. And for that to be dealt with in one place without having face-to-face contact with your lawyer was significantly worrying for a number of clients. And I say this again, I think there's a perception that all criminal accused are guilty, and it is just not the case. People deserve to be able to have face-to-face contact with their lawyer. And especially if that's a duty lawyer and the accused person has never been in custody before. Really important that their mind, to some extent, is put at rest and they know the person they're face-to-face with is looking after their best interests.
Okay, thank you. Could I maybe ask Vicky the same question and what her views are? Thanks.
Thank you, Minister. My understanding in relation to accused persons appearing virtually from a police station when in custody was brought about as a measure to prevent the spread of COVID. By not moving people around from police stations to court cells, up to courtrooms and so on. And the reason for that was proportionate. Moving forward, however, to agree with Stuart, following arrest, engagement with a solicitor is the first supportive experience for the person who has been accused and is in police custody. Is an anxious time. They are often anxious to understand what comes next, and lots of reassurance is required from the solicitor in that context. So whilst the solicitor is engaging with their client to understand what they're in police custody for, in order to then understand what might come next, there is an element of pastoral care to that. And creating that relationship in a remote way is challenging for the solicitor and for the person in police custody.
Okay, thanks very much, Vicky. I've got no further questions.
Thank you very much. We'll just move on to Fulton Mackay, who has some questions on this subject, and then we'll move on to another area of questioning. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Just for the record, Fulton McGregor. I get Fulton Mackay all the time. Oops. I think, Rona, you've called me Fulton Mackay once or twice as well. Is it? Thanks. Thank the witnesses for coming. I hope the witnesses and the convener don't mind. I'm actually wanting to go back a wee bit. Stuart, just slightly did there, it's actually to my the line of questioning that my colleague Rona Mackay was going on earlier, and I'm sure you'll be used to the the points that you've made being re-picked up on. So I do apologise for that. And can I say I really like your tenacity in terms of your work for people who are accused. And I think, you know, obviously it would seem that you would be really good to have on, you know, as a lawyer for somebody. However, I do want to also say on that same note that I do disagree with one of the comments that you made, and that was about the accused should have the right to see their accuser. And I can understand that from a general theoretical point of view, but some of the evidence that we've heard and hear across the board on a number of occasions and through different evidence gathering sessions is that that can actually be a really, really traumatic experience in some of the most heinous crimes that have been reported. And I gather that they are only alleged crimes at that stage, and I do understand the complexities around that. However, for me, what has become clear is there's also an access to justice issue, because we've talked a wee bit about access to justice for the accused if they're not getting a fair hearing and getting to have it in the old-fashioned pre-COVID way, if you like, which can include elements of virtual. But actually, if a victim or an alleged victim, sorry, is so scared or traumatised that he or she can't give evidence to the best of their ability as well, then also you've got another angle of an aspect of justice here. So I get that there's a balance on that. So I just wanted to come back to you on that point and ask, you know, do you not see any merit at all in continuing virtual hearings for certain types of offences, maybe domestic abuse offences, sexual offences, serious assault offences, these type of things? And if not, do you not see some way that has some sort of hybrid format, almost, as that's the word we're using now in the Parliament, for example, is that some sort of hybrid format that could be brought into it almost captured both elements of making sure the accused gets a fair hearing, but making sure that witnesses who have perhaps experienced really, really traumatic things actually can get to give their evidence in the best way possible. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a very good point you make. Just to be very clear, what I recall saying, and I stand to be corrected, Minister, but what I recall saying is that access to justice should be something that is spoken about in relation to everybody, so by the defence, by the Crown, by the Scottish Government Legal Aid Board, but also in respect of accused persons, complainers and witnesses. So access to justice covers everybody who comes into court, essentially, other than those professionals. To answer your question very specifically, yes, I absolutely think that there must be a process, a virtual, effectively, process in place which allows complainers, and that is the word we should be using, complainers, many, of course, who have gone through very traumatic experiences in the lead-up to the court process, there must be a process in place to allow them to give evidence in a way which negates as far as possible, and I say that because it's not always possible to negate all the concerns about coming to court. But of course, there has always been that process in place. And this, I think, is your question, frankly, highlights, I think, with respect to you, the lack of understanding of what takes place in a courtroom. Prior to the pandemic, and still during the pandemic, there are procedures in place which allow a witness to come to court, a complainer to come to court and give evidence by way of a video link from another part of that court. And this is something that I very briefly touched on earlier on in my evidence. So the pandemic, please don't make the mistake that the pandemic has brought in new procedures. What it's done is to bring in procedures that don't work particularly well. There have always been procedures in place in court. perhaps not always, but for some significant years now, there have been in place procedures in courts, both at a summary, solemn, sheriff and jury, and High Court level, where a witness can give evidence either by the use of screens in court or by video link from another place, either in the court or in a building nearby the court. And that applies to all vulnerable witnesses, from complainers in serious sexual assaults to children that are giving evidence in, let's say, I wouldn't call them not serious, but more minor summary level trials. That has always been the case. So, of course, we are in favour of that as a profession. It would be wholly inappropriate to put an extremely vulnerable witness through the process of literally coming face to face with their accused person. But that is not what this is about. That can proceed as always was. That was not impacted. It was impacted by the introduction of virtual trials, but it worked perfectly well before virtual trials were introduced.
Thank you, Stuart, for that. I'm sorry to run on about that subject here,
but it feels that there's a fundamental lack of understanding of what's happening in a court building during the process of trial.
I hear what you're saying, but I think I do think in defence of the whole committee, some of us have been members for of this committee for the second time. We're well aware of what was available pre-pandemic in terms of remote contributions. Some of us were involved in the Vulnerable Witnesses Scotland Bill. So I do accept that. I think what we're hearing now, though, is because of the pandemic, complete virtual trials are now something that is possible. And even from what we've heard from witnesses in some of the most extreme cases, even just going into a building and, OK, being in a different room and there being safeguards in place, but even just being in a different room in the same building as somebody who's accused. Sometimes these crimes carry real emotional abuse as well, and even being in that same building can impact. So I guess what my question was, I don't want to go back over it because I can feel the convener's eyes burning me here, and I know that there's I know we're on time, but I guess what I was asking, you can maybe come back into it in a later answer, was that it's fully virtual, and in some individuals, in some cases, not being anywhere near the building at all, appropriate for some cases. But I will, rather than go back to yourself, Stuart, at this point, I will pass back to the convener to decide what he wants to do next.
Can I just very quickly respond to that, because it's been put to me, I think it appropriate that I be able to respond appropriately. Yes, I accept that, but I say again that there are many accused persons who find it extremely stressful to come to court. And that's why earlier on I said that it may be that some accused persons feel that it's more appropriate for them to be able to deal with the matter by way of a virtual procedure. So it applies equally to both complainers and accused, as I see it. And only in a fair justice system can that be appropriate. It has to be appropriate in any fair justice system that the same rules apply to accused persons and to complainers.
I do take a point, yes.
Thank you very much. And I want to put on the record my apology to Mr. Fulton, Mr. McGregor. I didn't do that deliberately, for getting his name wrong. And now, before we move on to the next line of questioning, Rona Mackay says she has a very brief question, and I'd appreciate if we can keep the questions and answers as succinct as possible, given the time we have left.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to ask Vicky this question, please. In last week's session, Scottish Women's Aid and Victim Support Scotland agreed that the default for domestic abuse cases should be virtual courts. And I've just wondered if I could have your opinion on that, and if you agree that by the very nature of domestic abuse, it's not a one-off alleged offence, and that's why it's so urgent that these cases are dealt with, and there isn't there is a huge backlog, as we know. So if I could just have your opinion on that, please.
I agree with that observation. It can be distressing for complainers and witnesses, who can often be friends or relatives that coercive control is damaging, both physically and emotionally. And on the day of the trial, the focus of the witnesses is to talk about the things that have happened, and that in itself is a re-traumatising experience. And on a practical level, coming to the courtroom using the same entrance door to the building, the court building, sorry, not the room, checking in at reception, going to the bathroom, using public corridors, going for a coffee, using public corridors, the chance of passing the person who is accused or any of their relatives who may be there to support them can add to the re-traumatisation and the distress, and overall have an impact on how well a witness feels by the time they get into the witness box. There's a period of time where they wait and experience that additional human contact that adds to the pressure.
Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much. Now, just moving on to the next area of discussion, which is around time limits in criminal cases. And the first member to ask questions will be Jamie Green, followed by Audrey Nicol, who's joining us remotely. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our guests. Other parts of the legislation which I'd like to discuss today are around the criminal procedure time limits, which arose as a result of the pandemic. You of course, be aware of the temporary extension of the time limits, particularly around pre-trial in solemn cases. There was quite a substantial extension of the time limits that are normally imposed on cases. Time on remand until service of indictment was 80 days, extended to 60. Time on remand until pre-trial hearing was more than doubled, and time on remand until trial went from 140 days maximum up to 320. There were similar but not the same extensions in summary cases. I think we all probably appreciate that was to ensure that trials did not cases did not time out in any way, so they gave the Crown sufficient opportunity to proceed as appropriate given the context of the pandemic. But the bill seeks to make many of these a feature of our justice system, perhaps for the longer or indeed long term. Can I ask what your views are on these time limits and the extension thereof? Should we be looking favourably upon them? Should we not? And do you have a view on whether they serve their purpose and we should try, where possible, revert to the status quo or at least pre-pandemic time limits? And that question, maybe I'll start with Vicky and then Stuart.
Thank you, Minister. The Criminal Law Committee have discussed this particular part of the bill at length, and collectively we do not support these provisions for a number of reasons. We agree that swift action was necessary and proportionate when the first COVID legislation was imposed and extended time limits. That was necessary as a result of lockdown, social distancing, a period of time where no trials could proceed. And yes, time limits had to be protected so that cases did not fall. It is necessary to continue consideration of this area due to the backlog, but perhaps in a more tailored manner. There will be cases that do not require additional time, and there will be cases that do require additional time. As an example, cases that do require additional time could, for example, be a forensic evidence is awaited. The backlog and the pandemic has impacted forensic science laboratory labs, for example. So if they require to undertake forensic science analysis, to inform evidence in the case. The case needs to wait for that evidence before it can proceed to court. The Criminal Law Committee view is that it should be considered on a case-by-case basis. The additional matter that we discussed in this context is if a case is ready for court to be indicted or proceedings commenced, to consider the trauma-informed practice in relation to witnesses, complainers and accused. It can be challenging for people to wait indefinitely for a process to commence. And the justice system often sees the end being when evidence is finished, but when actually, from a trauma-informed perspective, when evidence is finished, that tends to be the start of recovery for a complainer. So if a complainer has a trial date to work towards, that can be more manageable and less challenging than just having a narrative which is there's a backlog, it might be a year, it might be two, we really don't know, we're waiting, you know, the case is waiting in the queue, so to speak. So the Criminal Law Committee are firmly of the view that this should be consulted upon in order for all of these factors to be considered and then reflected in whatever extension is made to the existing time limit provisions.
Thank you for outlining your reasons as to why you disagree with those elements of the bill. Stuart, I think we've also just in context heard that this is against the backdrop of the backlog of cases, and I wondered, and I hope I'm incorrect in assuming that because there is such a backlog, there's an inevitability about about extending the time limits simply because so many cases will simply not reach the first, second, third stages of the proceedings without some form of extension, and no one wants cases simply to fall off the edge of a cliff because they've reached technical time limits. That's not good for either the accused or the complainant, I presume. What's your view? What's the Bar Association's view?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it feels very much, Minister, that there's an inevitability to this, as you say. I think, unfortunately, I mean, going back in time now, I think there was an acceptance that there required to be an increase in the time limits because of the pandemic. And I think anybody that suggested otherwise would have been, you know, fairly churlish about it. But the reality is that throughout the course of the pandemic, the defence bars have felt that every measure taken by the Scottish Government or by the Board, or particularly by Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, has been two or three steps too late in the process. And it's now reached a stage where, you know, we've had clients on remand who are now getting so annoyed at us for their cases not proceeding to trial, and of course that's beyond our control entirely, that they are transferring to other firms in the, you know, the vain hope that another firm will be able to fast-track things for them, but that's just clearly not possible. It's for the Crown to decide who gets brought to court for trial. And so, in a roundabout way, it's actually costing the Legal Aid Board more money because these matters are time online, generally. They will get paid again for going through disclosure of evidence that's already been disclosed to another firm. And the reality is that these people are sitting on remand with no real access to jobs, no real access to coursework because they're not serving prisoners, very little time out of their cell every day, and they become increasingly, understandably frustrated. Now, at the very outset, what we were told is that the Crown would prioritise certain matters. So, for example, a one accused trial, rather than a multiple accused trial, and probably something that included a level of domestic abuse. And this is at the, to be clear, this is at the sheriff and jury level, not at the High Court level. But I have clients that have been sitting in court, sitting in the cells for nigh on 2 years now, and they qualify as that grouping of people that the Crown said they would prioritise, and they simply haven't been prioritised. There's no rhyme or reason to who gets taken for trial and who doesn't, I think, would be a fair way of putting it. And so there are people in there with very few convictions, and not always analogous, I have to say, with the matter they're on remand for, that are becoming increasingly frustrated. And it's bordering, I suppose, on Article 5 issues, you know, the right to liberty. There has to be something done about it. And many of these cases, and this is the added difficulty, many of these cases, on an application for bail, on an application for bail by the accused, it's really dependent on which judge or which sheriff is sitting on the bench on the day, because, you know, some people could be remanded for lengthy periods of time when a different judge might admit them to their liberty on bail. And so there's no continuity, there's no consistency. It's judge-led, basically. It's something that has to be readdressed and readdressed quickly.
Thank you for that. The issue of remand is a much wider issue, which I know the committee is looking at, and I think everyone is acutely aware of. There's a sad inevitability that some people may spend more time on remand than they ever would have done in their final sentence if proven guilty. But we can talk about that another day, Mr. Murray.
That is right.
Yeah, in the interest of time, I know the convener has questions on this subject. My other question is on the next topic, so I'll save it.
Okay, I think we do have time. I think Audrey Nicol is joining us next.
Thanks very much, convener. I just want to kind of follow on from the line of questioning from Jamie Green. And certainly I, on the face of it, I'm very concerned about the proposed extensions of time limits and the provisions within the bill on that, particularly in the context of remand, as Jamie Green has just highlighted. But I'd like, if I may, to pick up on your previous point in relation to virtual court proceedings. Now, I wonder if I think we would be agreed that there is benefit from a virtual option in terms of expediting and not at the expense of quality of court proceedings, if you like. But perhaps virtual proceedings have their place in terms of helping reduce the backlog and allow the processing of cases in a perhaps more timely manner. But I'm just interested, and I'll come to maybe Stuart first of all. On the one hand, you've expressed some concern about virtual court proceedings as an option, but would it be fair to say that in the current circumstances that we're facing post-COVID, they are a legitimate option within the court process, particularly in the context of helping avoid extended time scales for court proceedings to be undertaken and completed, thereby potentially avoiding the necessity for the time scales or time limits to be extended on a permanent basis? So I'll come to you, Stuart, first of all.
Yes, hi Audrey, thank you. My view is that they are not a legitimate alternative to what I would refer to as a traditional court process. It's an interesting thing because very often in court, more often than not probably, in most courts up and down the country, what you will find is that there are sort of inbuilt inherent delays. And, you know, it might appear that, you know, in a trial, for example, you just call one witness, that witness goes away, you bring another witness in. But, of course, this is the real world we're speaking about, and it's not always like that. And there usually are delays of one type or another, you know, and that might be to do with a witness having difficulty with someone looking after a child. It may be to do with a witness not feeling particularly well or running late, using public transport, any of these issues and more. And of course, when you introduce a virtual system, what you do is you increase the propensity, the potential for something going wrong. And that is generally what we have found, that by introducing a virtual system, you introduce another layer, another level of things that can go wrong on the day. So whilst it may appear that it's something that can help to expedite the backlog, it's our view generally as a bar that that's not the case. At the risk of repeating myself again, I do think that it could be a useful tool in the box. And as I say, bringing witnesses from Firth of the Border can be costly and can be time-consuming, can cause witnesses not to be able to be present because of public transport or delays or weather. And so I think that virtually there is a potentially there is the possibility of using virtual trial systems for witnesses like that, Firth of Scotland, or from, you know, or taking them from abroad, or something of that ilk, but not in the day-to-day running of the court. That is not working. And I think I can say on behalf of the entire bars in Scotland, it will not work. We have no faith in it. It is costing time and it is costing money, especially at what we hope that we're coming to the end of the pandemic, certainly in such a way that we can open cinemas again and open nightclubs again and allow people to travel. And in those circumstances, we don't understand as a profession why we can't bring witnesses back into court, because it worked before.
Thanks for that, Stuart. I don't know if Vicky wants to add anything in on that response. I'm just aware that colleagues are also wanting to ask some questions around time limits.
Nothing of value, I suspect, Minister, but just an observation that I hear what Stuart has to say about respecting the traditional position in which trials proceeded, but I also accept that when dealing with a backlog, additional short-term and longer-term measures are required to have any measurable impact.
Thanks very much. I'll leave it there and hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. I think we have a couple more questions on this subject. First of all, from Pauline McNeill, followed by Katie Clark.
As Jamie Green had indicated earlier, the time limits under the coronavirus bill, extending time limits quite extraordinarily to 320 days following a 140-day period, just give me cause for concern. I'd like to ask Stuart, you said in your evidence that the cases that are being called, there's no rhyme or reason as to which cases are being given priority. That also gives me cause for concern. I wondered if you could give any sort of guidance to me or members of the committee who are concerned about this, what could be the alternative way of going about this. So at the moment, if we were to agree these timescale extensions, it would be automatic for every single case. So you can see how that's going to go. Might it be your view that if we didn't extend those time limits, that there would be some discretion, or is there an alternative way? Meaning, on one view, that the court system is going to be such a mess in terms of availability of courts and so on, coming out of the pandemic. On another view of it, if we just simply allow it to go on for another year, or, you know, virtually a year, then I do agree that we might be verging on breaching of Article 5 in some way. I would welcome a response on that. Thank you.
Um, I think that we've now reached the point that there's a bottleneck in the system, and to continue the extension of the time limits is simply going to cause that bottleneck to fill up even longer. I mean, it just seems like a fairly common sense approach to me, you know, that the extension to the time limits was all taken because of the pandemic. I come from a family of doctors. I don't think in any way at all that I know anything about the pandemic, about how the pandemic should be dealt with, about how people should be treated. But without a doubt, I think I see common sense in things, and it seems to me that the extension of the time limits is not something that complies with common sense at all. I want to be able to say that the pandemic is over, and I can't say that. But, you know, again, repeating myself, I can only go on what the government is doing. And the government is allowing people back into nightclubs. The government is allowing people to travel. The government is allowing people to meet and congregate in large groups. And so it seems to me, as a layman, that the pandemic as we know it, hopefully, touch wood, is coming to a more manageable time. And so why therefore can we not manage the Scottish court system in a more appropriate and pragmatic way? And I'm sorry if that isn't filled with technical response, but I think it's a common sense issue. I mean, ultimately, we have people that are languishing in custody, and some of those people should not be there. And as one of your colleagues has just pointed out, many of these people, even if they're convicted, will have been on remand for significantly longer than they may have had a sentence. I think that's all I can say on the matter.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think Katie Clark's coming in now.
Thank you. I'll just pick up on some of the points that Pauline was making. If I come to Vicky first, it's quite clear that, you know, we've got a crisis. The word bottleneck has already been used. When we heard evidence from the Scottish Prison Service last week, they put the figure of the number of prisoners of remand within the system at 30%, which is higher than the previous figure we were given of 27%, which was the last official figure that we were given. So it's clear that the problem is one that we have to address. So what are the alternatives? What are the ways that we could change the system to try and address this crisis? Have you got any suggestions, Vicky, from your own experiences?
Thank you, Minister. Yes, the Criminal Law Committee have had a discussion about what could assist in alleviating the remand population. It is the Criminal Law Committee's understanding that persons arriving on remand has decreased, but the length of remand has increased. And it makes it look like the remand population is larger than we're used to, but it's due to the length of time of remand, not the number of remand, is our understanding. And in that context, we've spoken about measures that would reduce the remand population. So the first is electronic monitoring as a condition of bail. That may address offenders who might not otherwise be suitable for bail, but would be if they agreed to electronic monitoring as a condition. We also spoke about the recent sentencing guidelines for young offenders, so those under 25, and felt they would have a positive impact on future remand decisions for that age group. And the drive behind those sentencing guidelines to have a more trauma-informed response when dealing with young offenders. We spoke about the need not to have a blanket approach in extending time limits for those on remand, and to have a more tailored consideration. Is there a reason why this case needs to wait? What is the reason? And approach it in that way. Is there a reason this case does not need to wait? Put it into court, and that would be subject to views of victims groups likely welcomed by complainers and witnesses. As I explained before, it can be emotionally challenging waiting for a date, or more challenging than waiting when a date has been set for trial. It allows for coping strategies. You know, I have, as an example, I have 8 months until the trial. These are the strategies I can deploy in that time to cope with that pressure of waiting, versus I have no idea how long I need to wait. That is much more challenging to manage from a therapeutic well-being point of view.
So what I take from that is that you think that we need to review the current remand population and whether those individuals need to be where they are and whether there's alternatives in relation to that population.
Yes, if that population have suitable alternatives available, depending on their circumstances, because every decision is fact-specific, that would alleviate the prolonged remand and also protect the public from risk.
And if you think there's a need for a continued use of automatic time extensions, how long do you think it would be legitimate for that to continue?
One of the observations that the Criminal Law Committee did have when we discussed these time limits is, and that we couldn't understand the reasoning for, is that the increase in bail time limits, which we don't take issue with, is about 50%. But the increase in remand time limits is much greater than that. And we couldn't really see any reasoned consideration as to why that was. So normally a bail trial would commence within 12 months. The proposal is 18. Absolutely no difficulty with that. But the 140-day is increasing substantially more than that.
Mm-hmm. So a focus on those in custody prior to trial.
Yes.
Yes, I understand. And Stuart, would you be able to pick up on that in terms of what alternatives could you suggest to the committee as to what we do in the here and now, given the crisis that we face?
Well, I mean, I think simply, well, firstly, what I'd like to say is, in not answering your question, is I think that Vicky made a very appropriate and valid point, a really important point about complainers having to wait for the process as well. You know, my role is a defence agent, but I'm also an officer of the court, and all of my colleagues are officers of the court in the defence and the prosecution. And, you know, believe it or not, we do think about the complainers and the witnesses in these matters also. I think that to move things forward, the courts really have to be directed to view secondary applications or further applications for bail in a different manner. And they have to, you know, at the moment, certainly when an application is made for bail, it's not really a matter for the court to consider the length of time that that person's going to be on remand for. They may be able to look at other matters like lack of income to a family or something of that ilk, but ultimately the length of time they're on remand for is not a consideration for the court. And I would suggest that it perhaps should be a consideration for the court, and that perhaps secondary applications or third applications for bail could be considered in a different manner. And as Vicky says, whether that's being dealt with by way of you know, curfew orders, for example, or restriction of liberty type devices whereby they are kept within the confines of their own home or a suitable accommodation, then those are things that would take, that would allow some of that population to be given their liberty. Because I must come back to this, that these individuals are innocent until proven guilty. That is a fact.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Thank you. Now, we're just about out of our scheduled time, but I think we do have maybe 5-10 minutes more if the witnesses are happy to stay with us. The next area of questioning is the power around the early release of prisoners. And Rona Mackay and Jamie Green have both indicated they'd like to ask questions on this. So if Rona could go first, thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah. So the bill seeks to give the government powers to those similar to provided in 2020 to release groups of prisoners earlier than under the normal rules. And certain types of prisoners would be excluded from release. And I wonder if I could just have your opinion on that policy. And, you know, that there are some concerns, particularly from Victims Support Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid, about that happening. So if I could maybe come to Stuart first.
Yeah, I mean, I accept that. I think there should be certain groups of prisoners that are given early liberty. In saying that, I understand that there are certain groups of complainers and then, of course, victims by the time that the accused has been convicted, that those victims will undoubtedly have significant concerns about, I use the word attacker, but for example, their attacker being given an early date for liberation. I don't know quite how one gets away from that concern, for those legitimate concerns from those victims now. Victims. There are, of course, civil procedures that can be employed and, you know, potentially put in place to offer some protection to people that have those concerns. But of course, that's a new procedure, another procedure that victim has to go down in order to ensure his or her protection. So I'm not quite sure what the answer is to that. What I do think is that currently there are too many people in our jails. You know, in HMP Grampian and Peterhead, for example, there's been no young offenders in HMP Grampian for years now. It's been an underfunded and understaffed facility, and that in itself causes issues which impacts on prisoners, impacts on how they serve their time. It's a really complex question that I think that I don't think I have all the answers to, but I can see an argument from both sides.
Right, thank you, Stuart. If I could just ask Vicky to comment, please.
Thank you, Minister. The first observation that the Criminal Committee would offer is in relation to subsection 4, there are a list of categories of prisoners who would be considered not appropriate for early release. So a life prisoner, for example, we had thought prisoners who have been assessed as posing a serious risk of harm should perhaps fall into that criteria. In subsection 3, there is reference to a governor of a prison deciding that if released, the person would pose an immediate risk of harm to an identified person, risk of serious harm is not as specific as that, in that it's not an identified person. So that's the first observation. But in relation to continuing the provisions that would allow for early release, the Criminal Committee are supportive of that notion, not on a permanent basis, and on the condition that proper through care plans are created prior to release, so that prisoners have the support that they need to reintegrate.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Happy to hand over to my colleague.
Jamie Green. Yep.
Thank you. I'm going to keep this brief and probably request brief answers. I guess my fundamental question is, the power to release was granted to ministers by Parliament on the grounds of the public health emergency. In other words, for the safety and security of those within the prison environment. Is this a power that ministers should have? And I'm not talking about governors of individual institutions, against the backdrop of what is already a debatable presumption against automatic early release of short-term prisoners anyway. And secondly, is this a power that, even if you agree that it should be one that ministers should hold within the confines of a health emergency, should be one which is kept by ministers after the emergency, for example, in the case of any future potential health pandemics, and for that reason alone? And I'll start with Stuart. And Stuart, I would request if you could be relatively brief for that.
Yeah, I could be very brief if you want. I think that the second part of that question, I think it should be a power that ministers could have kept slightly further away than arm's distance. I think that it's an important power to have in situations like the pandemic that we've been going through. Should ministers have it? I suppose, yes, they have to have it in order to be able to do that. But, I don't think it took very long to get the Coronavirus Act in. So, I'm not just quite sure that there's a need for it to be a permanent fixture. It's something that can be revisited as and when it's required.
Thank you. That's a helpful suggestion. Perhaps something that, if ministers need the power, they can come back to Parliament and ask for it. I think we passed the coronavirus legislation in a matter of days, if I recall. Us sitting at the time. Vicky, do you have a view on that?
I agree with Stuart, and it would allow for proper parliamentary scrutiny about the proportionality of early release provisions.
Yeah. Helpfully brief as well. And my last and final question is, that is there any concern that having the power, it may be used as a perhaps blunt tool to reduce our prison population numbers, a point that Stuart alluded to, and in fact it may be used inadvertently not for public health reasons, but actually simply to get the numbers down. And there are other ways to get the numbers down, which we can have a wider discussion about, and I'm sure we will. But, given that the high rate of reoffending amongst the last cohort of prisoners who were released under this emergency power for public health reasons, a substantial amount of them went on to reoffend within a short space of time after release. That has struck bells of concern amongst many that we've taken evidence from already. Vicky, perhaps, do you have any view on that?
I'm sorry, could you repeat again the question? Apologies,
sure.
Minister.
The first time it was used under the premise of the public health emergency. Is there any concern or worry that having the power, it could be used as a more blunt tool simply to reduce our burgeoning prison population?
If they could demonstrate a commitment to proper through care planning around access to accommodation, benefits, medical services, the Criminal Law Committee would support in the short term the power, but not on any permanent fitting, for the reasons I've described around the lack of scrutiny.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, there may be one or two areas of questioning that we didn't cover off this morning just due to the time constraints, which we might follow up in writing to the witnesses. And also, if the witnesses feel they have any other points they would like to make to the committee, they could also write to us, put that in writing to us. I'd like to thank you both for taking the time to join us today and for giving us such frank and interesting evidence. So thank you very much. And we'll now move into a private session.